G'day, I'm Barnaby Joyce. Tonight's Australian Story is about a community in my electorate that is undertaking a bold social experiment. Mingoola sits on the Queensland New South Wales border, and with an ageing population, they tell me they're struggling to survive. But the locals aren't going down without a fight. They've come up with a plan that could help save other small rural towns across the country.
Mingoola, for lots of years, has been an ageing community, so we've got lots of older people, but we don't have many younger people. And the community is poorer without them.
50 years ago, there was a dance in the hall here once a month, and there was one in a wool shed up the road once a month. You know, there was a great social life. That social life has changed.
Maybe it's a bit of the sense of history. You don't wish to see a community die. And there's a lot of rural communities dying. And the life of any community is largely tied to children. There's not much joy in a place with no children.
Somehow we needed to get people in the area, and we needed people with families. We needed somehow to have something to get them back.
Mingoola community is loosely based on the Dimmerick River. We're on the dip of the Queensland, New South Wales border. There's a school and a hall. And it's just an area, really.
Your parents met there, didn't they?
Mingoola's an interesting area, and I'm a newcomer. I've only been here 33 years or 35 years.
I'm a child of the district. My father settled in the area in 1928. Originally it was all sheep and cattle.
And then after the Second World War, the Italian community came and which developed the tobacco industry.
Lots of migrants came for seasonal work. Some of them found it very difficult to fit in, and some of the locals found it very difficult to understand why these people had come. But eventually, there was an harmonious community came out of it. Everybody seemed to be prospering well, but the industry died.
Many of us have children who work in the city and aren't going to come back to the farm, because things have been so tough on the land.
Well, you notice the lack of children, especially at community events, you know, because they're the life and soul of the party, aren't they?
At the end of last year, it was announced that the school was going to be in recession, and it was just like the death knell of our community.
We simply ran out of children for the school.
The community was shattered because that's the hub of Mingoola, the hall and the school. It really affected Julia. But she wasn't taking it lying down, and she was going to lead the community in trying to have that school reopened. You know, I thought, well, good on you, Julia, but I didn't know how she was going to do it.
We're only running 9 minutes late. We'll have to hurry things up to try and catch that up.
As you all know, the school was in recession. The PNC met, decided to continue on as a PNC. The Mingoola community felt very strongly that we'd welcomed people before, historically, Most people were really happy at the idea of welcoming people again.
It's a bit like Field of Dreams, you know, they will come.
So then we started thinking we might be able to find some refugees who'd be happy to come and live in the valley. But every time I contacted any kind of refugee service, they all said, oh no, you know, these people need to stay in the city.
A response to a resolution of the Mingula Progress Association.
They need lots of counselling, lots of language support. They needed more than we had. So we had to find families that had been in Australia for long enough to be feeling okay about perhaps moving. The turning point came around the end of 2015 when Julia was able to link up with Emmanuel and his organisation.
2011, I came to Australia where I applied for a scholarship at the University of Sydney. I work as an advocate for my people who come from the Great Lakes region of Africa. It starts with the Congo, which is bordering so many countries, I think 9 of them.
We represent the refugees from Rwanda, Burundi, Uganda, and the Democratic Republic of Congo. These four countries have a common history of conflict, recent conflicts especially.
My family learned from Rwanda. People were just butchered and killed. Some people lost completely their family. Myself, I lost the whole family of my uncle.
Nearly 3 million people were displaced. Nearly half of them became refugees. Australia has resettled nearly 10,000 humanitarian refugees from this conflict.
Most of the people from my communities are really grateful to live in Australia. But many of them find it difficult when they get here.
Around 80% of resettled refugees from our communities come from agricultural backgrounds. They were really missing it. Like those people living in the city, in the fifth floor somewhere in this flat, you never have the time to reconnect with the land. That's what they've been doing for centuries, you know?
And what did you have in the lunchbox?
Oh, kufika, sijui ni kama vile Mungu alivileta.
Oh gosh, that's a very big meal.
Toa kanipa hapa sasa ndo ni kwako. Joni kaikala sasa ti baadaye lakini maisha nikaona yako magumu.
No. Who is number two?
And then he suggested why not to go into rural area.
Julia and I, we had this conversation of how our dreams are meeting. Their family are inviting me to come and see if our people would appreciate that area.
I was in the team which went to Mingula for the first time. It was in January this year. It looked pretty much similar to rural areas in my country.
There's one man who came and he found the landscape very close to his landscape in the Congo. He just stood there with the cattle and then he said, this has healed my soul.
Is it common to rent the land?
It's quite common. You put your cattle on there and the owner of the property is responsible for the maintenance of the cattle.
Around the district there were lots of small cottages that hadn't been lived in for a long time and were crying out for somebody to do something with them.
We went to look at the houses and I was totally embarrassed because the houses were in great need of repainting. There was quite a lot of work that needed to be done in the kitchens. And
the electrician is coming next week to rewire it.
Wow.
But they weren't totally unfazed by that.
We're thinking if we put a veranda on the side as well.
Yeah.
But as you can see...
How about an outside kitchen?
Yeah, well, they really wanted an outside
Yeah, that's an African thing. Yeah.
Love the outside kitchen.
Yeah.
Many of their aspirations were the sort of things that we felt were important to how we live. It was very important to them to be able to have a friendly greeting from a neighbour.
I was brought up in a household that couldn't speak English, and I did say, look, coming from the migrant background that I'd come from, I want to raise a few realities to you. First of all, if you don't like it here, you just can't walk down the road and catch a bus and get away from here. You know, you're in a remote area. They said, we are African, we know.
Philip and Julia went ahead and pushed this quite quickly. And, you know, they're compassionate people doing it from the heart. But a lot of people in the area were concerned about the lack of employment. I think the biggest fear we had was we would be introducing these people into a poverty trap. I know one of my neighbours has said that bringing these people in has the potential, if it falls apart, to set neighbour against neighbour and have people who've been friends for years opposed to each other, and we don't want that to happen.
We might go and sit down and have some dinner. Right. Dinner's on the table. Yeah. My son William, he said he thought you were a sucker.
We were feeling a bit of pressure, a bit of responsibility that if these people were going to make their lives up here, we had to make the whole project work.
We're going to get some dairy calves.
Oh, for them? Mm.
And the kids can feed them.
So we agreed that this was a good go, and we said, let's give it a chance. And even before 1 week, I had more than 50 people, more than 50 families registered, ready to go to live in Mingura.
I don't think we ever really, in our wildest dreams, expected that these people would really want to come so much and want to come so quickly to get out of the city. Manuel came back with the first two families who put their names down. They arrived the day before Anzac Day. One family was staying with us because their house wasn't ready. I did note that there were a lot of children in these families. I thought, well, there's a good thing.
Small buildings and big backyards.
Friendly, everybody's friendly.
Everyone's friendly and you get to ride horses.
Renata and Isaac have 9 kids. Vanessa and Jonathan have 7.
I think that a lot of these people had a very difficult past because of the trauma they've suffered. So we don't ask them. We just don't ask.
My name is Isaac. I come from Burundi.
Papa na mama barafuwe mukuru wanje we yafuye namaze we namaze guhunga bamwiciye ahantu bamuta mu ishamba
ko byagenze narapfushije basaza wanje babiri barapfa barabishe
When they come to kill people, we just hide. If you hide together with your family, they can kill all family. I was with my brother. When we hear it's just like people scream something, and my mother died. So
Yeah, freedom, yeah, and a peace. That's why things decided to come to live here. Yeah.
For the families who have moved, having a garden helps them to heal from their depression and all the trauma that they had. It was like going back to their roots, I think.
Wait, those are the cabbage as well?
Yeah.
Renata said that it has been more than 16 years since she had a garden.
They want to plow all this land, dig as far as those trees.
Renata and Finesse have probably hoed up more than a hectare, maybe two. It's just incredible how much garden they've managed to produce in 3 months.
We've been using backpackers that in the last few months we've been employing the couple of African refugee families with picking pumpkins and a little bit of time in wool shed work. They're doing a good job.
So there may not be long-term full-time employment, however, there's long-term seasonal employment.
And these people do enjoy working, and they're very keen to see their children succeed.
I like cooking cakes. I just went to jail like I did the lemon slice. Lemon slice.
What's your favourite thing at doing at school?
Maths.
Mine's spelling and writing. Eliara, what's your favourite thing to do at school?
Cook.
The first day of second term this year, the school reopened its doors for the new family that had arrived, and it was very exciting for all of us.
They were nervous and excited, but they were ready for it.
Hi, we are Mingula School. We are very unique. Last time it was closed, but I'm glad it's not because we do lots of fun learning. We do music on Mondays.
I think everyone has fallen in love with the kids. The kids are magnificent. They're beautifully mannered, very clever, and just got just a nice balance of cheek about them. So that's good.
Every time I drive out, they give me a wave from the skill yard and a kiwi, and they're really nice.
And you have to measure out 8 tablespoons of...
Yeah,
you do the measuring. I'll hold it.
You know what? They've struck a bond, and that bond's reflected in the way this program's working.
His mother called him Wild Thing, and Max said, "I'll eat you up," which was very good. I guess the remarkable thing is that the people we've found love them here, and we love them, so... And when he came to the place where the wild things are, they roared their terrible roars and gnashed their terrible teeth and rolled their terrible eyes and showed their terrible claws.
No, he's not scared.
No, he's not scared.
Only sad.
We've got to take this out.
Yeah.
This comes off. Then we lift these. She wants the laundry outside.
Oh!
By September, we were very excited and we were getting ourselves ready for the arrival of the next family.
What is your relationship to student? You're the parent.
Parent, yeah.
Yes. And the given name?
Kofi.
Kofi, he left Congo under similar circumstances as any other refugees from our area. There was a war. People were dying, and people had to run for their life.
Mkwana watoto hiyo wakati. Mkwana mtoto mmoja alikufia mkambi. Alikuwa na miwili na nusu.
Okay.
Very sad.
I think they're singing a song.
Kofi, he has 7 kids, him and the wife, so they are 9 in the family.
Kofi is packed and ready to move. That's what he's told us. We're just working out the logistics and getting, so we, as soon as that house is habitable, well, he'll be able to move in.
It's too heavy. It cannot be a problem of the police on no, road.
Hey, Emmanuel.
Good man. You have my cups. Morning, little fella. How are you?
I'm good.
2 weeks ago, come to Mingula with my family. She's happy, my wife. Us, me too, I'm happy. You feel good. If someone help you, you can be happy. You can be sad.
I asked him what skills he had, and he said, I dig. So I gather he's a fairly keen gardener.
These are the new kids of Mingula. This is Mabale, this is Jolly, that's Emmanuel, and this is Bahati.
Mabale.
Oh, future. Nahezi penda kama nimezeeka, nijue nimeachia mtoto kitu gani. Nao wanasema baba alikuwaka naye mtu alitusaidiaka.
Comment ça va?
When it was suggested to him he might like to try his hand at planting pecans, he was really happy to go.
I would take a new bus.
Yeah.
We've got Nick and Louise from France and Kofi, who's just started today, and he's giving a bit of it a go, see how he goes. You've got to be a hard worker. It's hot and sometimes long hours.
I got to work. To pick up nut will be maybe permanent job.
They want their children to see them working, and they want to teach their children to work as well. They don't want their children growing up not knowing what it is to get their hands dirty.
So we spread the news about Mingula to the community, and the amazing thing is like it went all over Australia, not only in Sydney. Queensland, Melbourne. We had more than 100 families interested to move. And some of them had perceptions that they're going to be given houses, lands, animals, things that we didn't tell them.
We've had endless people ring us or come or just turn up, you know. I keep saying... Please stop telling people about Mingula.
Very happy?
No. No, I'm Australian women. We're all really strong. The brutal truth is, you know, we have 4 houses and we couldn't sustain more than 4 families anyway. In our small community, it's just not really possible.
The measure of the success of this in the long term will be whether people can get off Centrelink support and become totally independent.
You from Adelaide too?
Yes.
Everyone's been very generous. However, I would strongly recommend there needs to be a lease or some documentation protecting both sides in case there's any issues.
I think it's early days. But if this works, then we can say to other rural areas, why don't you try it too?
I currently have a person in another area that has a few empty houses that's looking at the same program and has already spoken to Julia.
The involvement of the local community is the key ingredient.
It's part of our CWA to welcome these new people. They're all settling in the district.
If our people want to move in, but they don't feel welcomed, I don't think that there will be any success for the project. Yeah.
We're just decorating, aren't we, James, for a welcoming party for Coffee and his family.
Really? Hello. Hello.
Most people who can come are coming, so it'll be good. It's not a huge community, but, you know, it's big enough. It's just got so much bigger.
Yeah.
We're realistic. We know that nothing's ever perfect. But I've been stunned by the generosity of our community. Like the man who dropped off the two goats that he'd caught with his dogs, knowing that goat is the best meat for these people, they just love it.
With a special like welcome, Alderman and Consulata. Anyway, put your hands together and welcome everyone that's new. Thank you very much.
Our priority is, are they happy? Because, you know, they weren't happy in the city, but they've made so many friends.
The people of Mingula is good people, friendly people, lovely people. I don't know how I can say about the things they do for us. I can't describe that.
It's like a family.
Yeah. For me, I think that is like my mom and dad, my dad. Yeah.
We've got this mishmash of people. Somehow, we fit beautifully together.
Oh,